Welcome to our presentation titled Evaluating Testing the Qualitative Way, featuring Michael Bolton of DevelopSense Incorporated. I'm your host, Francesca Mature. Now, before we begin, I'd like to explain how to participate in today's event. This presentation contains streaming video and content. To optimize your bandwidth, please be sure to close any unnecessary applications that may be running in the background. You'll notice a widgets toolbar at the bottom of your console. And, well, I'd like to present Michael Bolton.
Sound. I used to work in theater a long time ago. My goodness, that's nice and big. What a great thank you to the AV people. They're invisible to us. They're like testers. They're invisible to us most of the time, and they make it possible for people to do work. So let's hear it for the audio people. And the conference organizers, and especially Lee. I'm Michael Bolton. I'm not the singer. I'm not the guy from Office Space. I'm no relation to that guy, I swear. I don't like him. Those of you who are following along on your screens or something like that will probably recognize that the slides that you have are not exactly the same as the slides that you're going to see. That's okay. The talk is not the slides. The slides are not the talk. If you want a copy of what I'm going to present today, you can mail me, or you can get it off my website. So we'll do that. This is a personal experience report. I'm a dilettante when it comes to qualitative research. I'm just learning how to do this stuff, and I've only been researching it the last couple of years. I'm really excited by it, though. It's lots and lots of fun. It's very interesting and very engaging. But what I'm observing, what I'm finding, is that there are these books that I neglected to take out of my bag. Let's see if I can take them out without making the thing feed back. It's a series of books from a publisher called Sage Publications, and they make these amazing little tiny books, and they charge like $40 for a book this thick. And a lot of people say, that's $40 for a book that's only that size. Well, you know what? It's kind of like a test report. All right, test script. The value of it is not in the size. The value of it's in the content. So I'll refer to a couple of these books perhaps as we go through. But I'd like to thank people who contributed to this talk. Predominantly, the biggest influence on me in this talk has been Kem Kaner, who'd be familiar to you, as the author of Testing Computer Software, the author of Lessons Learned in Software Testing. My colleague, James Bach, who is a co-author of Rapid Software Testing, I'm delighted to say that we're starting to catch on. Rapid Software Testing is being adopted by lots of places worldwide, including at Barclays Capital, where Keith has been working. And I'm excited about that, too, because it's a way of doing testing more quickly, less expensively, and it puts the tester at the center of things. That's what we want to do. We want to focus on developing tester skill. So this morning, I'm going to talk about things that I think are provide us with avenues where we can start to develop skills that will help management to identify qualitative aspects of the product. After all, if we're in, some of us say that we're in quality assurance, let's use qualitative techniques to describe what we're doing. So, Lord Kelvin, remember him? The scientist, the great scientist, he said, I often say that when you can measure what you're speaking about and express it in numbers, you know something about it. But when you cannot express it in numbers, your knowledge is of a meager and unsatisfactory kind. It may be the beginning of knowledge, but you have scarcely in your thoughts advanced to the stage of science, whatever the matter might be. He also said, heavier than air flight is impossible. He also said, there's no future for radio. So the radios on commercial aircraft these days would probably really throw him. But the most important thing, you get a lot of people talking about that quote. A lot of the measurement people talk about that quote, but they miss something really important. which is the sentence that comes before that in Lord Kelvin's description. In physical science, he says, in physical science, the first essential step in the direction of learning in any subject is to find principles of numerical reckoning and practical methods for measuring some quality connected with it. Physical science, that's my emphasis. Here's what I'm going to say back to Lord Kelvin. If you're dealing with things that are about people and what they value, and if you express things only in terms of numbers, and if those numbers don't connect to what people value, then your knowledge is definitely of a meager and unsatisfactory kind. The trouble is that in testing, we have a bad case of physics envy. We want to discover natural laws about testing so that we can make the kinds of predictions that you can make, things like stopping distance for a car, physical aspects of things, the kind of a numerical reckoning that people use when they want to discover a new natural law. But there's a problem with that. The problem with that is that in physics, human beings are a kind of irritant. Human beings don't behave according to natural laws. Humans are ornery. Humans are unpredictable. Humans do stuff irrationally, based on what they want. So it always bothered me. It bothered me for a long time that we were trying to use physics-like forms of measurement, physics-like forms of evaluation, in order to figure out things about what is naturally a human activity, which is the development of a software. It didn't seem to me to make sense. Then I saw this fantastic pair of talks delivered over one day, in fact, in Waterloo, Ontario, and Toronto, Ontario, in 2006, by Kem Kaner. He was up visiting to give some talks to testing associations in those two cities. And I had the privilege of chauffeuring him around. And he did a talk called Software Testing as a Social Science. And these are some of the points that I've lifted directly from his talk. That social sciences study humans in social organizations, in society. Social organizations like development teams, businesses, labs, communities. And the questions that social sciences ask is not what are the all-governing physical laws, but what effect will things have on people? What will the impact of things be on people? Now, because people aren't subject to physical laws in the same way that things like automobiles and airplanes are, social sciences combine quantitative measures where they're appropriate and qualitative measures where qualitative measures can't go. The consequence of this is that the results that we get are kind of ambiguous and they're context specific. After all, social situations vary. Things are different in Beijing than they are here in Orlando, and different still in Stockholm and in Utrecht. In that kind of milieu, questions about what people value, issues of ethics come to the fore, and they're definitely relevant. And because of the social situations vary, diversity of the results vary. The results may not generalize from one place to another. Another thing is that people are observing other people, and therefore there's going to be observer bias. It's normal, and we can't get rid of it. That's acknowledged by the social scientists. Instead of getting rid of it, though, we try to acknowledge it and manage it. We deal with it. We can't get rid of it. And then, in the course of making these points, Kem said something which he didn't put in his talk, and I think only recently has made it to any of his printed material. But I, for years, was trying to urge him to do this, because as soon as he said it, I dived from my moleskin notebook and wrote it down right away. And I turned up and looked at my friend Adam White, who is also in the room, and he had taken out his moleskin too. He was starting to write it down. Kem said that what the social sciences provide us with is not absolute laws of nature. The social sciences provide us with partial answers that might be useful. That's what testing does. Testing can't be complete. Testing can't tell you how everybody is going to accept the product. Testing can give us partial answers that might be useful. So I was really excited by that. So I started to do some probing into it. And as a somewhat sloppy researcher, I have forgotten exactly which publication I got this from, but it's either from Trockim, a website on social research methods, or from this book over here, Reliability and Validity in Qualitative Research. Delicious. Little tiny book here. Qualitative research is about identifying whether something's there or not and the degree to which it's there. It's about things that might be abstract, might be subjective. And one of the funny things in this book, I'll just read you a little tiny slice of it here, is to identify something, the observer knows what qualifies as that thing or that kind of thing. This entails counting to one. Have we got one like this or one not like this? And the funny thing about that, it occurred to me, was even things that are highly physical, highly qualitative, involve decisions about, do we have one of these, or is it not one of these? Which group do we put it in? Even in physics, this is a big deal, it's a big question. Is Pluto a planet, or isn't it? Are those things out in the Kuiper Belt, are they brown dwarfs, or are they not? And some people might say, some astronomers say, what they are, and some astronomers say they aren't. Well, who cares? I mean, they're things, they're out there. Well, it matters a great deal because if those things out in the Kuiper Belt aren't brown dwarfs, then our whole theory about brown dwarfs is wrong. Or if they are brown dwarfs, I forget the detail on that. But the point is, our classification systems are based on qualitative evaluations at a certain level. So even quantitative measurement is highly influenced by qualitative aspects. In the qualitative research milieu, we have to really probe at whether our classifications are accurate or not. And it seems that in quantitative research, they don't think about that quite so often. I guess because qualitative research is sometimes controversial. And it's hard to pin down whether you got one of these or one of those. Qualitative researchers have to take a lot more care in describing what it is that they're looking at. So, some aspects of qualitative research. Putting human values first. Getting people actually engaged with the people that they are researching. Participant observation is one of the tools of that. A little book here called Participant Observation. Let me just give you a couple of snippets from this. The participant observer rarely depends on a single form of evidence. Concepts are formulated and checked by multiple procedures and forms of evidence, such as direct experience and observation, different forms of interviews, and different informants, artifacts, and documents. Does that sound anything at all like testing work? It does, it seems to me. It's extremely important to ask whether or not and the extent to which the researchers' procedures have provided direct access to the insider's world, both about the products that we test and the environments in which the products are going to be used. I think it's important to ask those kinds of questions. The methodology of participant observation, more than most scientific approaches, requires the researcher to describe and discuss fully the procedures used to collect information. Doesn't that sound like really excellent testing work? Doesn't that sound like the work that excellent testers do? Explicit, detailed discussion of study procedures subjects them further to public examination and scrutiny. It's just as Keith said, if our customers scrutinize our work and they don't understand it, then the work that we're doing is not so valuable to people. In order to do that well, I think we have to learn to tell stories well. We need to recognize that for qualitative researchers, what we're going to discover is not entirely clear from the outset of the research project. It takes time to figure that out, and it takes loops of investigation. One of the things that you'll find in Cresswell's book on qualitative research is that a research study is not a line. It doesn't start at a certain point and go straight through to the end. There's lots of loops. There's lots of blind alleys. There's lots of investigation. There's lots of exploration. Good qualitative research is an exploratory process. Just like, I would argue, good testing of a product that we're only learning about. We don't know about the product when we set out to develop it. We don't know what to expect and what to find. We don't know what's going to happen through the course of developing it. There's a wonderful passage, which I'll get to in a moment, in another one of the books on literature review. And in qualitative research, the researchers, when it's really done well, do evaluate the literature, but they don't take it as conclusive. We'll return to that point. Concept mapping, writing memos, coding, which is essentially putting labels on our observations. Those are things that qualitative researchers do. And there's great concern, as I alluded to earlier, and which I'll also come back to, about reliability and validity in the way we observe and the way we measure. Now, why is this important? Well, a few years ago, Kem Kaner was given the assignment by his dean at Florida Institute of Technology to write a first-year programming course. And he went to all the books, and he looked at all the introductory texts on computer programming, and they all said the same thing. They all said that a computer program was a set of instructions for a computer. You know, I looked up the word obvious in the dictionary the other day, and it said, seven-letter word beginning with O. Well, duh. A computer program is a set of instructions for a computer. Doesn't that leave something out? And Kem's argument was that that's like saying that a house is a set of building materials arranged in the house design pattern. Whereas we would rather think of a house as something for people to live in. Now, if you look at this picture, drawn by a kid, of what a house is, you'll notice a couple of really interesting things right away. First of all, the people are bigger than the house. But kids don't do that because they're stupid. Medieval artists didn't make the figure of Christ much larger than everybody else because they were stupid. They didn't make the lords and ladies bigger than the peasants who were dancing under the table, if you look at medieval art. They didn't do it that way because they didn't know how to draw. They did it that way because that's the way their minds worked. That's where their mindset worked. It worked that way because they were drawing stuff in proportion to its importance to them, it's their importance to the world, to their culture, to their society, to their religion. When kids draw stuff like this, you'll notice that they don't draw a house in isolation. If you ask a kid to draw a house, there's always one thing, at least one other thing that's going to be in the picture, and that's a great big Mr. Sun. But you'll see a system there. You see dogs and trees and grass. The kids recognize that the house appears in a context, that the house is something for people to live in, that it has a relationship with people. That's why it's so important to take a definition like a set of instructions for a computer and add to that. That's what Kem did. He said that a computer program is a communication. It's a medium among several people and computers that are separated over distance and time, and that communications happens to consist of instructions that can be run on a computer. But But then he emphasized in his course that the purpose of a computer program is to deliver value to people. That's what a computer program is all about. It's a communication between people. That means that a program is far more than its code. A product is far more than a set of instructions to the device and the manual for how to use it. That quality is not just about absence of bugs. Jerry Weinberg gives a wonderful explanation a wonderful example of this. When he talks about, imagine a program with no bugs in it. No bugs at all. Perfectly written program. No coding errors. The purpose of the program is to produce a horoscope for Aubrey Morton Winstanley III, a hardware store clerk in Minneapolis who died in 1939. You can have a perfect program. It doesn't provide any value. So quality is far more than that. Quality is about delivering value to people. And that means that testing is far more than confirming that the program gives an expected, predicted result. Testing is not checking. It's a particular hobby horse of mine. A check is an observation linked to a decision rule such that the observation and the decision rule can be applied non-sapiently, that is, without human wisdom and judgment. Our test scripts look a lot like that. And it's especially lame when they're written for people. If you've got a test script, if you've got a check you want to perform, I say give it to a machine. Let the machine do the work. The machine produces bits far faster, far more precisely than people do. But if you want to understand something about the project, you've got to remember that quality is value to some person, not just a production of bits. Even if they're the correct bits. So my definition, my working definition for quality these days, and as James Bach argues, I think everybody who works in testing should invent testing for themselves. That is, they should have their own working definition for what testing is. They should understand what testing is. Software testing, for me, is the investigation of systems. Systems that are composed of program code, of computers, of related systems. Most importantly, of people and the relationship between all those things and all those people. So, what is testing? I mean, we could look at testing as a branch of computer science, a bunch of mathematical operations that we perform on a computer program to prove it correct in the mathematical sense of proof. But it seems to me that leaves a whole lot of stuff out. It leaves out the whole people develop or aspect of things, of software development. So, instead, we could think of testing as something much more like anthropology, where there is a DNA, there are biochemical and physical things, mathematical things in human systems. Biology, genomics, proteomics, kinematics, the physical aspects of human existence. But there's so many other things as well. To be human means that we produce artifacts. And we can examine artifacts and people's relationships to artifacts. We can examine the way people use language, the ways language might lead to understanding or confusion. We can analyze what people do inside their cultures, and we can observe that. By doing that, I argue we would make testing far more powerful because it would be about delivering value to people by examining the things that people value and their relationship to the products that we're developing. So part of getting interested in anthropology involved finding out something about this guy, Wade Davis, a Canadian author. He has the coolest title in the world. His title is Explorer in Residence for the National Geographic Society. Isn't that a weird title? Explorer in Residence? How do you be an explorer in residence? Well, he works in the National Geographic Society. He's traveled all over the world investigating cultures. And there's a fantastic talk that he gives as a TED talk. A couple of snippets really resonated for me with respect to testing. One of the things he says is that every language we develop is an old growth forest to the mind. And we have a terrible problem these days. If biological diversity is being under assault, linguistic diversity is under terrible pressure right now. At the beginning of the last century, there were 7,000 spoken languages. Now there are fewer than 6. And a new language goes dark every 2 weeks. Another language goes dark, another spoken language, an old language, I mean, really. Another spoken language disappears. The last speaker of a language disappears every 2 weeks. That is catastrophic, he says, for humanity, because every language evolves in order to solve a problem for a group of people in a specific place. And that's why I think the idea of a standard language for testing is bogus. A standard language for testing would only make sense if we had a standard language for software development. And that would only make sense if we had standard products that we wanted to develop for standard purposes. And by the way, it would only make sense if we could get bugs to follow the standards too. Other cultures, other ways of doing things are not failed attempts to be modern. We look at other cultures and we use our culture, Western culture, as a lens by which to judge them. But world cultures have evolved and developed all over the world in order to solve problems for people in their context and in their environment. The anthropologists say we should honor that, and I think as testers we should too. We need that, he says, especially in the future because of climate change. We're going to need all of the ideas that humanity can bring. And it goes back to something that Keith said this morning. Everybody in this room has ideas that they can bring to the table. Software testing is more powerful because of your uniqueness, your individuality. Your development culture is valuable because of the unique things that it can do. Another aspect of anthropology that's terribly important, according to Wade Davis, is the storytelling aspect. He says that we believe storytelling can change the world. Well, in the rapid software testing view of things, we believe that it's a job of the tester to create 3 interwoven stories that form a kind of braid and that give each other backbone. A story about the product, how it works, what it does, how it fails, how it might fail in ways that add or threaten value for our clients. But in order to give that story its backbone, in order to give that story its support, its legitimacy, its warrant, we also need to tell a story about how we tested, what we did to configure the product, operate it, observe it, evaluate it, what we did to design our tests. What we did and what we didn't do, and what we're not going to do. And then to ask our clients, are you okay with that? Is this the kind of testing that you want? Because it's that second level product story that gives backbone to the first level product story. But in order for that second level product story to have its warrant, we also need to tell a third level story, which is a story about the quality of the testing that we did. What makes it risky? What makes it costly? What makes it valuable? What makes it harder or slower? That means we need to report issues, things that threaten the value of our testing, not just things that threaten the value of the product, but things that might compromise the value of our testing so that we reduce the chance that we'll miss important problems. That includes talking about how testable the product is, or problems with testability. Because testability problems means that it's going to be harder or slower to find bugs. And what we need, what we recommend in order to make testing more powerful. Those 3 stories braid together, strengthen each other, give each other support, so that we can tell a real story about the product. The reason that we do that is because testing has to be focused on learning.
learning about something which is being developed under conditions of uncertainty, of extreme time pressure, often great ambition, often tremendous risk, tremendous volatility. And that means that testing has to be about exploring the product space, exploring the project space, designing, executing, discovering, investigating, learning, and reporting in loops. Very big loops, very small loops, very tight loops, very rapid feedback. That feedback is what allows us to tune the product and to tune the testing in order to make sure that we get the testing and the product that we want. I mentioned before the relationship that qualitative researchers have to literature review, to looking at documentation. And Maxwell, in this book right here, Qualitative Research Design, Maxwell says something really interesting. He says that documented knowledge is always behind the knowledge that's in the heads of people who are actually doing the work. If you're a qualitative researcher, yeah, literature review is a good thing to do, but you got to remember that what's current has not been written down or published yet. The most current stuff is in the heads of the people who are around us. And that means conversation. That means interviewing. That means talking to people. That means getting out of the lab and moving around and having conversations with people who are actually doing the current work. That means, for testers, talking to people who use the products. It means going to conferences. It means joining tester groups. It means communicating with one another via blogs, via magazine articles, via tweets. Any active area, the current knowledge base is not in the library. It's in the invisible college of informal associations among research workers. For research workers, read testers. Another thing about documentation that we're handed in order to help us with our test design is that some of it's more relevant than others. That conversation helps us check the value, test the value, if you like, of our documentation. Is our documentation really telling us what we want it to do? Another aspect is that our task in describing something is not only descriptive. In fact, I think I need to refer specifically to what he says on that point. That if you focus too much on the literature as a qualitative researcher or on documented requirements or specifications, it can lead you to think that your task is simply descriptive, to report what previous researchers have found or what theories have been proposed. In constructing a conceptual framework, your purpose is not only descriptive but also critical. You need to understand and clearly communicate what problems there have been with previous research and theory, what contradictions or holes you have found in existing views, and how your study, how you're testing, can make an original contribution to our understanding. That's entirely consistent with something that I found in one of James's presentations. Don't restrict your testing to stated requirements, because requirements, most requirements in a product, I would argue, go unstated. How many people here have reviewed a specification that says at the end of every paragraph, and the product shall not crash? And the product shall not unreasonably slow down the user's task. And the product shall not annoy or frustrate the user. You don't see that at the end of every paragraph because it's implicit. It's our duty to report anything that threatens value, not just inconsistencies with documented requirements. One of our colleagues, a guy named John Stevenson, has got very excited lately about grounded theory. Grounded theory is a qualitative research approach in which you try to understand something by starting with observation and developing your theories as you go. We do that when we reverse engineer a product. We do that when we examine a product, inspect a product, interact with a product, when we have limited documentation, when we have limited information of any kind. We do exactly grounded theory when we investigate a bug or when we probe a confusing situation. That process is by its nature iterative. It starts with basic questions that are designed to generate ideas, but those questions are open questions. They're not confining questions. They're not confirmatory questions. They're not checks. They're testing. And testing is not an artifact. Testing is an activity. Testing is a performance. It's not a document. A test is not a document. A test is a performance. In the same way that a piece of Irish traditional music that I play, it's not a bunch of dots and lines on a page. It's performance. It's people sitting playing music for the enjoyment of themselves and for other people. In grounded theory, researchers look at the data, look at the situation, and they perform loops, exploratory loops, that link theories and data. If the theory doesn't fit the data, it's wrong. And so they keep going through those loops of questioning the theory and questioning the data. So testing a product is grounded theory about a product and its relationship to people. Here's some little things that qualitative researchers do. Memoing. Coding. Not coding in the sense of writing a computer program, but coding in the sense of designing a system of classifying observations and noting their presence and absence, the degree to which they're present and absent. That, by the way, underscores an important point. Qualitative research doesn't reject quantitative research. It uses quantities to illustrate and to assess the degree of things. It doesn't reject quantitative measurement, but it puts quantitative measurement in its place. It's more important for us to understand what we're looking at before we start trying to count things. I'll give some examples of that a little bit later on. A memo in qualitative research speak, and memoing, the act of memoing, is the act of writing down reflections, observations about the research that's under process and about your mental set and setting, about the data that you've seen. It's kind of like reflective journaling. It also attempts, when it's done well, to be self-critical. You might write exploratory essays. You might write notes to yourself in one of my favorite testing tools, which is this Moleskine notebook. I got a big one for writing a conference. I got a little one for I can jam into a pocket or into a backpack and use it to record ideas that come to me. It's a useful thing, a very useful thing I found, to keep that handy all the time, and to peruse it, reflect on it, look back on it. One of the little tricks I do with this is that somebody in a conference in Germany laughed at me for this. They said, "Don't you think this is kind of anal?" No, it's not. See, I have my name on the side there, so if they drop it, people know who it belongs to. And I also try to keep on the side an index so that I can stack them back up there that refers to the date where I keep it. You can write anything you like on the side of it to try to make it as handy and as accessible as possible. I write observations and reflections and stuff on that. The other day, when I was in England, I watched a programmer trying to test a little exercise program, and I cataloged what the programmer is doing. That way I can talk about what I've seen, evaluate it, look at that reflectively with my colleagues and with myself later on. Blogging is a way of doing this, but Maxwell, in his book, says be careful about that, because if you believe that you're writing for an audience, that will distort the reflective nature of the thing. That you're writing for yourself. You're writing to try to interact with your ideas and not to interact with anybody else. So blogging sometimes is that way, but usually the consciousness that we're dealing with an audience in a blog distorts to some degree the goal of the exercise. Concept mapping is another thing that gets used a whole lot in qualitative research these days. So I thought, as a little exercise, I'd look at another idiom, another domain in which qualitative techniques were used a lot, the domain of news reporting. Because when you think about it, a test report and a news report have a lot in common. So I broke down a news report into the basic questions that news reports ask. Who, what, why, where, when, and how. And probed those, went in deeper and asked more detailed questions about that. Because it seems to me that if we wanted to evaluate the quality of a news report, that we would ask questions about that news report. I've taken these questions and I put them into a slightly more readable form here. Go through a news report, and if you wanted to evaluate the quality of that story, you would ask questions about the who part. Does the story tell us who did it, who it affected?
Who's writing the report? Who's producing the report?
How do we assess the reporter's credibility? Well, I think we do it by going down a list like this. Does a reporter describe what was happening before and then what happened? What else was happening? What was happening in parallel? What else was happening that might have an influence on things? What might happen next? It's interesting because the more I went through this exercise, the more I realized that newspaper reporters, TV news reporters, are like testers. When we report on what we did as testers, when we report on what the product is doing, we need to ask ourselves, what happened? Who will it affect? How will it affect them? Where did it happen? Where did we look? Where did we not look? Where else could we look? Why does the product do this? What's the purpose of it? What's the motivation? You know, one of the things I see in specifications a lot is a set of things a program should do. What I don't see so often is why the program should do it. What's our motivation? If we're not connected with what the program is supposed to do, why it's supposed to do it, if we can't connect those dots, it seems to me that there's a very strong possibility that we will miss important problems. John Bach gave me a great lesson a few years ago. We were at a conference and he was talking about what he does when he first engages with a program. And you'll see in qualitative research, one of the things that's really important is the concept of engagement, engaging with the object of your research, engaging with people. And John said, you know, when I first get a product, I engage with it, I look at it, and I don't look for bugs. And I said, what? That's crazy talk. How can you not look for bugs? You're a tester, aren't you? And he said, no. He says, I don't. Not at first. He says, I look for benefits. I look for what the program should do. I look at the value that it should provide. That way, he said, I get to build a model of the product that allows me to make much better decisions, much sharper decisions about whether I'm seeing a bug or not. Because if I don't understand how people would value the product, then I can't really credibly understand threats to value. I found that really powerful, really important, because I realized that was a flaw in the way I approached testing. That as a tester, it's so exciting to find bugs. It's so wonderful to find bugs. In early stages, it's really tempting to go in there and find all the bugs you can. But maybe we should pause before we do that and start asking questions about the product and how people would obtain value from it. So that led me, that looking into that process of creating a coding system for news reports, that led me to ask, wait a second, aren't test reports like news reports? There's a headline, a summary. There's a body. If you're going to write a really good test report, people who are making decisions, as Keith pointed out, don't have a lot of time. So we need to build the story in, what could we use? What about the newspaper's classic pyramid lead? First paragraph of the report. Who, what, why, where, when, and how. What's important here? And then loops, larger and larger loops of how we got that story, what the story was, more details as the story gets lower down on the page. What are our sources of information? Who's the reporter? Where did they get their information? What observations are people making in order to add backbone to the story? And then some interpretation, why it matters, how it matters. What's the meaning and significance of the story? Are we keeping our observations and our inferences, the extensions of what we believe, are we keeping them separate? Are there pictures, drawings, diagrams, illustrations? Are those provided in order to help with understanding where they're helpful, where they're useful? Tables of data, are they around? Background information, in order to understand the point of this story, what do we need in order to establish as a backstory for it? And what are the interactions with time? Are we telling a narrative? Are we telling the story in a way that inheres with time? So several years ago, I was at an organization in which we processed
The easiest way to put it is that banking transactions of one kind or another, and it involved receiving information from one party and moving the data to another party. And there was a problem. The problem was that the support people, the customer support people, seemed to be spending about 66% of their time, two-thirds of their time or so, dealing with problems associated with only two of the 283 member banks in this particular network. So that was the first step, identifying an effect on people. There was something happening that was taking up a lot of their time. So I went and I interviewed them. I talked to them. I spoke to them. Asked them a lot of questions about what the problem seemed to be, how the users were having difficulty with it. I then developed a theory on what the problem might be in the software. I polished and sharpened up my research questions. I interacted with the product. I engaged with the product in order to find out what it was. Now, let me tell you what it was. The thing is that people who were not members of, or who did not have accounts at the five big banks in Canada, when they were receiving money from other people using an email money transfer, they had to provide a bank account number for the account where they wanted the money to be deposited. And in order to do that, they had to read the MICR numbers, the magnetic ink character recognition numbers, on the bottom of their checks. But various banks did this in various kinds of ways. It made it harder or easier for people to read it. And there were a couple of them that only provided six-digit bank accounts, and our field wanted a seven-digit bank account, which most of the other banks provided. So it's kind of interesting because a lot of people sussed out that a zero at the beginning of the bank account would do. That's what our software, it turns out, was actually expecting. And a lot of people didn't realize that. They put a zero in at the end, where it would be a check digit. The zero, the last digit of the number, was typically a check digit in which they do a mathematical operation on the other six digits. The catch was that every now and again, zero would be the right number by accident. Right? There's a one in chance number that that check digit would be a zero. And it was those particular transactions that were causing the problems for people. Well, I thought, how could this happen? So the other thing I had to do was look at the specifications for this. And I realized there were a couple of bugs in the specification as well. The other thing I had to do was to get hold of a sample check from one of the banks. And fortunately, there was a bank not too far away from our offices. So I went downstairs, went down the street, and at lunchtime, I snagged a counter check from them. And lo and behold, it turns out my grounded theory was correct. And so I built a story of that there was a chain of six or seven bugs, any one of which, had we addressed them, would have dampened this problem. If we got two or three of them, the problem would have gone away completely. So I had to tell a story and construct a narrative about that. In retrospect, I recognize that the elements of qualitative research that I did here put me in a position where the director of development said, and I kind of agree with him because I felt very proud of this stuff, he said that this was the best testing work that he'd ever seen. I felt like it was kind of the best testing work that I'd ever done too, so I agreed with him. That part was kind of nice. The point is that this was not sitting in front of a computer and checking to make sure that we got the expected predicted result from some function. Our fitness test did not find this problem. Our fitness test did not investigate this problem. Coding. I mentioned that before in terms of a newspaper story. And it struck me that if we want to do exploratory testing really well, if we want to evaluate the quality of testing in an exploratory way, one of the things that we have to do is we have to set up a set of things that we could observe and evaluate about that testing. See, managers have this problem. They think that exploratory testing is like this ad hoc, unstructured, undocumented form of testing. But exploratory testing has tons of structure. Look. I
I'm happy to send you a map if you send it to that email address, or actually if you just ask me a nice question and use any address at DevelopSense.com. I'll happily send you a copy of this map that's actually readable. But another thing you can do right away, there's a list of dimensions of exploratory testing that's available. It was written by James and John Bach and me. And if you use your search engine and point it at the expression exploratory testing dynamics, you'll find that right away. We're trying to develop stuff like this. We're trying to use qualitative research approaches so that we can evaluate, we can help people evaluate the quality of their exploratory testing, finding dimensions of it, aspects of it that might matter. Ideas like, when you're engaged in an exploratory activity, when you're engaged in exploratory testing, one of the things that you have to think about is generation of ideas. Are ideas being generated as you test? Are you elaborating on those ideas? Are you abandoning those ideas when we overproduce them? Are you recovering those ideas when you realize that there's time to investigate those ideas, or when you realize that the ideas that you abandoned might be important than more important than the ideas you're looking at the moment? Are you recovering those ideas? Are you branching, backtracking? Those are exploratory testing tactics. Are you recording your work using notes, using video capture? These are the things that we could actually do in order to analyze and evaluate the quality of the exploratory testing work. Are you modeling the product? Are you chartering? How do we evaluate the charters? Is it concise? Is it sufficiently concise? Is it sufficiently open? Is it sufficiently closed in order to help us frame a 90-minute session of testing? Are you time boxing your sessions? Or are you following a thread-based approach, which is another way of doing exploratory testing? The point is, if we can codify it, if we can label aspects of it, that can help us to observe and evaluate it and establish an answer to the fundamental question of testing and the fundamental question of testing our testing. Are you okay with that? Not is this right or wrong, not does this follow some kind of a quantitative evaluation. Are you doing the appropriate number of test cases? But are you engaged with investigation of the product? That's not exactly a quantitatively easily analyzable question, but with qualitative measures we can do that. See, there are two different ways of thinking about measurement. It seems to me, at least two. One is to think of measurement as the application of numbers based on a model or theory to attributes of objects or events for the purpose of describing them. Kem Kaner and Pat Bond talk about that in a very important paper, hugely important paper, called Software Engineering Metrics. What do they measure and how do we know? I urge anybody who's involved with testing, anybody who's involved with measurement programs especially, to read that paper. And as soon as you finish that little snack, it's only 12 pages, go on to the book that Keith mentioned this morning, Bob Austin's Measuring and Managing Performance in Organization. There's another way to think about measurement, though. To think of it in a more first-order kind of way, as Jerry Weinberg describes in his book, Quality Software Management, Volume 2, First-Order Measurement. Because before we even get down to the numbers, we have to decide whether it's worth it to go for those numbers, and that's a first-order evaluation. So we need to think about validity and reliability of our observations. And the problem of reliability and validity is really important when we recognize that we're using surrogate measures all the time. We're always trying to estimate the quality of something when we use numbers. Almost all the quantitative measurements of anything are about trying to estimate something that matters to people. Now, we can estimate that very precisely with physical laws, using a form of measurement that Jerry refers to as third-order measurement, the kind of measurement that we can reproduce and analyze extremely repeatably, extremely reliably. But with humans, we can't do that because there's so many variables flying around. With that kind of measurement, we have to think more in terms of trust, more in terms of credibility, dependability. just as Keith said, I'm startled and delighted that he anticipated this. We're always looking at a subset of the people who are customers of our information. And when we can't connect those observations to value to business people, value to users, and we're always sampling the business people and the users that we're talking to, it seems to me, we will be ignored if we can't connect those things to value. Interestingly, qualitative research seemed to be much more engaged with the idea of validity and reliability, probably because qualitative research, exploratory research, tends to reveal surprises. This is kind of interesting because this is a big relationship to testing as well, it seems to me. That so much of the testing that people seem to do, that people seem to talk about in testing books and at conferences and stuff, so much of that seems to be focused on confirmation. But then this delightful little quote from Kirk and Miller's book, that most of the technology of confirmatory non-qualitative research in both the social and natural sciences is aimed at preventing discovery. That is a wonderful little quote I'd like to read from you there too, because that's really exciting. He says, or they say, when confirmatory research goes smoothly, everything comes out precisely as expected. Happy path. Received theory is supported by one more example of its usefulness and requires no change. As in everyday social life, confirmation is exactly the absence of insight. Hello, repeated tests. In science, as in life, dramatic new discoveries must almost by definition be accidental or serendipitous. Indeed, they occur only in consequence of some kind of mistake. A mistake in our theory or a mistake in the thing that we're examining. That's why this book, from which I was just quoting, reliability and validity in qualitative research is so important, I think, for testers to read. Slim little book, takes a little bit of effort, well worth it. Validity for qualitative researchers is about the idea of reducing alternative interpretations, reducing alternative hypotheses, so that you can credibly say, this is happening, and this is why I can say it's happening. Reliability has a couple of different interpretations in the world. Reliability in quantitative research seems to be about the extent to which you can see the same thing in different places at different times. But there's a problem with that in testing. The number of platforms that we run our tests on, the variety of sequences of operations, the variations in timing, those things make repeated testing impossible in any kind of complete sense. So we have to pay attention to what aspects of the tests that we are repeating in order for our tests to be reliable. Two kinds of validity that are very important to think about. Construct validity, is it one of these or one of those questions? Is this thing that we're observing an instance of that category? Is this one of these or not one of these? And then external validity, the question of if we see this pattern of behavior over here, can we generalize that to other places? Why is that important? How big is a vehicle? How many vehicles are there in Orlando, let's say? Those are both vehicles. What do we count as vehicles? And what's the relevant of that object? Now, how big is a test case? See what I mean? Test cases don't have a whole lot of construct validity until we know something specific about them, and often we don't. Counting test cases, it seems to me, doesn't make any sense. I mean, what would we make of this statement? Woody Allen saying, I worried about 56 things today. And three of them were catastrophic, and two of them were only mild concerns. The other 34 were base-level worries. Yeah, that doesn't make sense to me. The count doesn't tell us anything, it seems to me. What we need to talk about is a story of problems. Our obsession with counting and our obsession with reliability and repeatability, I think, come from the fact that we confuse those two things. Reliability, validity, and generalizability, dependability, trustworthiness is what we're actually seeking in our tests, because on a computer, repetition is very easy to achieve. Programs are pretty deterministic. Machinery is quite reliable in the sense that it doesn't break down. What we need to do, as Jerry Weinberg suggested in 1961, is to assess adaptability in testing. Does a program take whatever we're going to throw at it in varying situations and varying concerns? That requires us to vary what we're doing. It requires us to develop new questions and to vary the questions that we're asking. To sum up, there's a fabulous series on CBC Radio called How to Think About Science. It's downloadable, or not downloadable, I think it's streamable, but if you're clever, you can figure out how to download it too. The first interview in that series, a 1 hour or so interview with a guy named Simon Schaffer. Simon Schaffer is a historian of science and a sociologist of science. And he and a bunch of colleagues in the 1980s and 90s looked at the fact that science itself, for all it wants to make claims about truth and objectivity and reliability itself, is a heavily socially constructed enterprise. That science is an institution, and that institutions are created by people. And they're subject to all the political and all the emotional things that people get up to. And that science is changed by that. His colleagues decided that they would do something interesting. And it was shocking and horrifying to a bunch of scientists. They decided that they would look at science using the tools of science itself. They would use scientific research methods on scientists working in labs, working in botanical gardens, working in zoos. What they found was very interesting. That scientists were not terribly good at managing skepticism, as scientists said they were. What they were really good at, what really startlingly good at, was managing trust. That they weren't some kind of priesthood, that they weren't much smarter, much wiser than the rest of us. That instead what they were really good at was constructing very carefully designed workspaces. And it struck me, scientists and testers have these things in common. There is also a great deal of controversy in the scientific world. Well, largely through that research over the last few years, also because physics is kind of stuck, we've seen an ascendancy of different kinds of sciences. System-oriented scientists like field botany, agronomy. How come this plant grows over here and not over there? How come this particular phenomenon happens in this place and not in that place? What are the social conditions that make agile software development work in this context and not so much in that context? Why is this program accepted by these users and rejected by other users? Those are systems-oriented sciences. So he says the pattern science is no longer theoretical physics, but those field sciences. The other thing that he says is very important is that we have to stop looking at what scientists say they do and look at what they actually do. Stop looking at the process manual for information about what people do in development projects and start looking at what people actually do in software development. That, I think, is the key to the whole thing, that we need to use qualitative research methods in order to attach the observations of our testing and the observations of how we do our testing to the value that people want to obtain from it. If our goal is to reveal quality information, then we need, as a trade, as a community, to sharpen our skills in the way professionals do qualitative research. That seems to me to be a worthy goal. Thank you very much. I do.
Thanks, Mike. Hello. Oh, all right. Michael, thanks very much for this thought-provoking talk. We have a break now from 11 to 11:30. Our concurrent session started at 11:30. Lunch is 12:30.
Francisco. That wraps up this event. Thank you for joining us. Please check the Presentation Center for other presentations and their start times. And don't forget, join us for our live interviews between presentations. And as a matter of fact, we have one that's about to start with Lloyd Royden. Roden. So if you go and click on the Interviews tab, you'll see that we are about to interview with Lloyd Roden. So I invite you to go check that out. Otherwise, we'll see you at future events.